trying to call Bob to pop up and proclaim, I see you have forgot your password, please enter a new password. and so the conclusion here is Microsoft Bob hacking sprint. So here you got a few of the details of this problem. You got the gist of it, and anything through is all repeated stories. But since we can get Bob in running online stuff, we can verify this one. So there's my good friend and dog Dan. There is no Microsoft Bob character in here that I know of. But there is a dog wearing the Bob logo on his collar. So whenever you go to log into Microsoft Bob, it asks you for your password. Type your password in. And it'll tell you it's not right. And so you try it again. And a couple more times later, it's actually more polite than Gary McGraw stated. The dog says, pardon me, have you forgotten your password? And you can tell it no, but we're obviously going to tell it yes. What password would you like? Type it in. There's even a little note saying, the little symbols that show up when you type is my way of disguising your password. This way, someone looking over your shoulder can tell it. Never mind. And here the student actors notes that's looking at the slide that I instead of okay, it's now A-okay on the side. Very friendly. So this verifies as a 17-year-old vulnerability. And also we're looking at insecure storage and credentials. This is where we're getting into the whole password hashing thing and hashing with solves and things like that. The software we're talking about today does it so wrong that it could be an improvement if it just hashed it in the first place. So this is actually just looking at, in Microsoft Bob's files here, the utopia.mdb, it's an access database, I believe, that you can just open up straight up in a viewer. Now, the Bob one uses an old version of the access database. Some MDB viewers like it, some don't, maybe you find one of those. And so you can see down here that there's the Wesley McGrew user there. That is my real birthday, if you want to give it something. With gender field, unique identifier, and my password, which is over here. There's also some other users built into the thing that the system doesn't really tell you about. There's one that doesn't show up on the user list from within Bob, and it's called the and the password is secret. Very mysterious stuff there in Microsoft Bob. So Microsoft has done a lot of changes. I don't think that they'll mind me talking bad about Bob. But it's been 17 years. Microsoft's made a lot of progress, and of course we forgive them. Can we forgive them? No. But software is a lot harder to break now. It's mainstream IT software that's harder to break because we have people that are working on breaking it all the time. You break Internet Explorer, you break Microsoft Windows, and boom, you've got millions and millions of people that are vulnerable to that, and that's sexy, and that's fun to talk about. But what about lost tribes of software? What about tribes of software that's in different genres that don't see a lot of attention vulnerability analysts, such as SCADA HMI software. Now that's getting more and more interest, of course. But for a long, long time, this software was developed without a whole lot of scrutiny as to the security features. It has security features, then we give it standard approval and send it out. But what you're going to see here is that this software has vulnerabilities in it that are very reminiscent of what you would see in mainstream IT software in the mid-90s. So, for finding design flaws in HMI software today, you can go up to your hotel room and do this and find some zero day, I promise you. And you can put away your fuzzer, you can put away your copy of Show Coders Handbook, you can forget everything you knew about memory corruption and still do this. All you have to do is read the documentation for the security features that particular HMI package provides and just verify that it actually does it. And a lot of times it doesn't, or it does it in such an insecure way that you can easily be broken. So the first steps for this is an older vulnerability that I reported a couple of years ago, and this was basically my first go at SCADA HMI software. You have GPANET's iPIC software. They weren't very happy about this. But essentially, their passwords were stored exclusive or against the static key. So who knows what that means, essentially. Okay, about half of it. So the idea, and I'm going to kind of cover this in a little more detail here. This is, if you went to Law's talk on the DC 101 type stuff, he talked a little bit about exclusive or and why that can be good, why that can be bad. The idea is this, these passwords were stored XOR against a static key that was the same key for every user and the same key for every system that IPX was installed on. So if you had a trial version of IPX, you could go and pop those out and pop those keys out. Network authentication in this case, and this actually turned it into something somewhat remotely being exploitable. The documentation for network authentication in IPX suggested that you put the password file on an SMB network share